is actually something that people are studying, understanding maybe a little bit better the causality, but there is no final word yet. So we only know that there is a slightly larger contribution than one would expect, given the state of the business cycle.
I'm having a technical problem, not sure what changed, but at the moment I can either have the presentation here or on Zoom. Now it's on Zoom, but not here. That's a problem.
Maybe we can stop the presentation on
Zoom. Yeah. Because that's easy. That's like this.
Okay. So let me start then with the presentation. So why did we get to start this paper? Well, you know, if you are in a central bank, you know that at any time, at any point in time, you need to assess the forces that are affecting inflation to understand whether they are persistently or more temporarily affecting inflation, because monetary policy acts with a lag. So it only makes sense to really counter shocks that have a persistent nature. And this type of analysis gets concrete into the so-called projections of central banks. But these projections are not just one path, so a point forecast. What we do during the projection is also to assess the likelihood of different scenarios. And in the jargon of econometrics, this means basically doing effectively a density forecasting, not just one path, but forecasting the whole also the whole uncertainty you expect to be around this central path. So accurate density forecasts are a fundamental input for monetary policy, but the question is, of course, how do you do it? And if you remember my small introduction before showing the slides, there are several criticisms which have been posed to the models typically used by central banks. Now, there is also a paper that was produced during the strategy review by colleagues, in which they pointed out that indeed the modeling toolbox used in the euro system is strongly skewed towards linear models. And yet a large part of the inflation theory papers, but also more and more empirical papers, point out to the relevance of the linearities. For example, right now there is a discussion that to the way down, commodity prices have a much more sluggish effect on inflation than to the way up. So to the way up, they affect quite quickly inflation, but to the way down, because say downward nominal wage rigidities, for example, but other frictions as well, the pass-through is much slower. This is actually a nonlinearity and asymmetry in the effect of commodity prices. So what we want to do in this paper is to understand, also related to what I told you in the beginning, how relevant it is for density forecasting to account for nonlinearities. And how do we do it? Well, on the way, we also try to put some innovation into the modeling toolbox of the euro system, because we look into the machine learning literature that has not been yet strongly developed for this type of studies, although some people here in the room have been using it for other reasons. For example, I know Lucia has a paper with a colleague of mine on forecasting asset prices with the type of models that we'll be using here. We also assess, we also use this model to compare it to linear models to assess the role of nonlinearities. If this model has a much better forecasting performance out of sample, then we can probably say that nonlinearities are relevant and we should study more of them for euro area inflation dynamics. We use a so-called out-of-sample accuracy. You know, some of you will understand exactly why, but let me also give you an intuition for why we think it's important to use out-of-sample accuracy as a criterion to understand this question on linearity and nonlinearity. So if you have a nonlinear model which is very flexible, chances are that you give a certain sample of data to this model and it will be able to fit it perfectly because of its flexibility. But does it mean that it's any good, this model? Well, probably it's not, because we know that reality also has some level of randomness. So what you're doing effectively is to fit randomness, which you would not want to do. And how do you realize that you are fitting too much? And in jargon of econometrics, overfitting. Well, estimate the model on one sample, try it out on another sample, and then if you were fitting randomness, the randomness in the other sample, which is different, will tell you, oh, you're doing really a lousy job. And then you go back to the drawing room, the drawing board, and you change your model. So this out-of-sample is fundamental for this type, answering this type of question on you know, comparing models, and in this case, linear and nonlinear models. So the model we use is called the quantile regression forest. This is a variant of a famous random forest. And it's very nice because it's effectively a non-parametric model. We will not have to take any stance on the relationship between variables. So it's super general, and if there are no linearities, we'll probably pick them. The cost to pay, as you will see, is that they are difficult to interpret, but at least for this question, linearity, no linearity seems to be a nice choice. So here, this is a relatively technical slide. Let me not dwell on it. I just want to tell you that the relevant part here is that we are estimating the relationship between inflation, its lags, and the set of predictors via this function M. This can be anything, can be nonlinear, linear, whatever. This is where this quantile regression forest is involved. We also, in a regular presentation, we discuss more about the model. Let me not do it here in the interest of not boring you too much. I just told you what the model is. This is actually going to be a combination of a large number of potentially nonlinear models. If some of you are interested, we can actually discuss it in the Q&A or after the presentation. In our autosample exercise, we will look at, we have data starting January 1992 up to December 22, right? And we use 20 years of autosample evaluation, so a very large period, starting from the beginning of 2002 to the end of 2022. We look at four forecasting horizons, two that we call short, 3 and 6, and 9 and 12 that we call long, although these to the standard of econometrics are also short horizon. And we use some criteria for evaluating the forecast, which are effectively distance measures. So when these numbers are large, this means that the forecast is bad because it's far from the truth. And one is for density forecast, the other one for point forecast. In the model, we need to decide what are the predictors for inflation. And in order to decide that, we basically just look at standard macroeconomic theory. The core variable, the core relationship in macroeconomics is called the Phillips curve that relates inflation to inflation expectations, relativity variable, cost variable, global variable like commodity prices and so on. So we will have a sample of 60 predictors in these broad classes. And then to effectively check whether inflation dynamics are more characterized by linear or non-linear dynamic, we compare it to a state-of-the-art linear model. This is a combination of Bayesian vector autoregressive models, so basically a state-of-the-art for macroeconomic forecasting with linear model. It is a combination and not just one model, because this nonlinear model is also a combination. Because we want to just isolate the linear versus nonlinear dimension, we do not want differences in the design of the models to affect the comparison. But we would have had other possibilities. Now, we also want to say whether our models are interesting for policymakers. We do not only want to have an intellectual debate on linearity and non-linearity, so we also compare our projections, so our inflation forecast, with survey and institutional forecast. So these are the survey of professional forecasters and the projection of the Eurosystem called BNPE. Today I will only focus on the BNPE. These are judgmental, so in the sense that they are produced by models, but then there is also the judgment of the forecasters, putting information coming from, for example, from things that you know about the future. For example, if you know that Germany is voting for a VAT, then you want to integrate that into your forecast because that will actually push inflation forward. So being similar or competitive with this type of forecast is actually very relevant for a mechanical model like ours, because it would mean that managed to squeeze so much information from the past that even having this disadvantage that they do not know future information still makes them competitive. So this is what we are trying to fit or to forecast. The black line is headline inflation in the euro area. So this is the wider basket, including all the consumer prices with the weights that the euro system considers correct for the inflation basket. You see that there is at the beginning of this chart, there is the final tail of the inflation convergence at the beginning of the European Monetary Union, quiescence of inflation around 2%, jump up because of the commodity price boom because of before the great financial crisis, and then the drop because of the recession, long period of low inflation, and then the final boom when inflation really reached the levels that have been not seen in this sample, only seen in the 70s. The smoother blue dashed line is core inflation. This is actually just a measure of core inflation where from the consumer basket, we take out the most volatile prices, which are energy and food. Okay, this is just one measure because you know, we have in mind many much more sophisticated measures. Claudio has one recently in a paper of his where different criteria are used to derive core inflation. You see that also core inflation is much smoother. For example, didn't experience the booms in the commodity price in the period of the Great Recession, but recently it also went up. And actually, as a matter of fact, now headline inflation is retracing while core inflation has been a little bit more stable. So let me just give you a summary of the result, and then I want to focus on a couple of results. First of all, our nonlinear model is competitive with the linear benchmark. It's actually on par. It's as accurate as a linear model for headline inflation, a short horizon, and is a bit worse for long horizon. It's generally better for core inflation, but by a small margin. Okay, so this does not speak in favor of a very strong role for nonlinearities. There might be maybe a bit more for core inflation, but not a huge role. It also turns out to be competitive with institutional forecasts, especially at short horizon. On horizon on 9 and 12, these forecasts are much better. So what do we conclude from this? And this actually relates to my initial introduction, that these nonlinear models are at best a complement and not a substitute for the models that we have been using so far in central banks. And the nonlinearity doesn't seem to be that pervasive, okay? In particular, because these models are actually worse for headline inflation than for core inflation, which is basically headline inflation minus energy prices and food prices, it seems that the direct effect of commodity prices, which affect directly energy and food prices, are characterized effectively by linearity, okay? This is why a linear model is better for headline inflation than for core inflation. Now, this is very relevant because one of the debates about why central banks have been doing badly on inflation forecasting is saying that it's because we are missing the nonlinearity in the relationship of commodity prices with inflation. It doesn't seem to be the case. It looks like these effects are actually by and large linear. It might be that there is no linearity in the commodity markets themselves. But once you have the commodity prices, the effect from commodity prices to consumer prices seem to be linear, at least the direct effect going directly into energy and food. The indirect effect may be affecting other elements of the basket. Maybe that's a different story. And in fact, for core inflation, we have a bit more evidence of nonlinearity. Let me just go through some small chart, and then I will conclude. So what does it mean that these models are similar? So here we now, from now on, we'll just focus on the horizon of 6 months ahead where our model does quite well. And here what I'm doing is to look over time at measures of the performance on the left side for headline inflation, right side for core inflation. Because I want to check, does it mean that these forecasts are actually the same? So they are always the same, or it is that they are, you know, differently good in different periods of time, so different enough to be in effect complement. And then on average, they're similar. And the answer is more the second. So the black line, sorry, the red line is a measure of inaccuracy of the nonlinear model computed at each point only looking at the previous 3 years. So it's a performance over time. The black line instead is the same measure for the linear model. And you see that during the great financial crisis for headline inflation, the nonlinear model was doing worse. This is by and large probably exactly because the effect of commodity prices to energy and food component of CP, of HICP are linear. But then during the period of low inflation before the recent increase in inflation, actually the nonlinear model was doing consistently better. And then high inflation came and both models were really bad. You see that actually having a nonlinear model here would not have been a solution for us to do a better forecast. For core inflation, the story is a bit different. This this basket is much less affected by the direct effect of commodity prices. And then indeed, you can see that the overperformance of the nonlinear model is more consistent, although also in the case of core inflation, at the end of the sample, the two will be very similar. Another element which is very relevant is, this is a very surprising chart. Here I have as a black line headline inflation. The red area is the density forecast coming from the nonlinear model. And the green is the Eurosystem forecast of inflation. And you see that incredibly, despite the fact that the Eurosystem toolbox is pretty much a linear toolbox, this forecast is really tracing the median of the forecast. So you would have expected a little bit more difference, given that by and large the models used here, the Euro system, are linear models. And here, what we conclude in the paper is this is a judgmental forecast. And we know that actually a large part of the narrative, this judgment narrative, is of a mildly non-linear way. For example, people say, as I was telling you before, commodity prices might have a different effect depending on the level of commodity prices. So our guess here is that despite the fact the model is the modeling toolbox is linear, the judgment induced into the forecast by forecasters has a sort of effect of skewing the forecast towards a more nonlinear type. And here, actually, what we are doing in this very ugly slide is to just support that view, because what we compute here in the blue line for the nonlinear model and in the red line for the Eurosystem forecast is the distance from nonlinearity. The distance from linearity. The linearity is our linear benchmark, okay? What you can see is that these two gaps that we call distance from linearity are very correlated. And then, you know, this is showing you really that the judgment seems to consistently put some nonlinearity into the forecast. Let me conclude here with the last slide, where we try to open a bit of the black box of these nonlinear models by looking at the contribution of different variables, different relevant predictors to the forecast that we have. And here for the blue dots is core inflation, the red dots are headline inflation. In this panel, we have a short interest rate predictor, unemployment rate, wages, and inflation expectations. On the horizontal line is the value of the variable. On the vertical line, you read the contribution to the projections. So this is basically when you look at these lines, you can understand the relationship that this variable have with the predictor. And you see that by and large, actually, these relationships are plausible and characterized by linearity. So these dots are a lot on the same line. There are some exceptions. For example, we know that the short-term interest rate hit the zero lower bound at some point. And there you see that the points do not line up on a line anymore. So there is an obvious nonlinearity. But generally, these three predictors are characterized by linearity. The exception is inflation expectation, and in particular for the blue dots, core inflation. You see that there, basically, there is a muted relationship. But when a lot of people, this is the right part of the chart, start to think that inflation is going to be high, all of a sudden inflation will pick up, okay? This is an obvious nonlinear relationship because there is a sort of segmented trend, if you segmented the linear line. So this is to say that even this analysis that opens the black box a little bit seems to say that there are not incredibly relevant nonlinearities. Some variables have nonlinear relationships with inflation. Here we're not talking about causal relationship, it's a predictive relationship. And more for core inflation than for headline inflation. So let me conclude here. So what we saw in this presentation is that it's not obvious that nonlinearities are really fundamental to do inflation forecasting. They are relevant in some period for some variables, in particular for core inflation. Seems to me, related to the introduction I gave you, that this idea that having had a different modeling toolbox would have led to a completely different monetary policy is a bit far-fetched. I think actually that from this analysis, one of the conclusions I personally draw is that we do need to learn to live with uncertainty. There are going to be forecast errors also in the future, persistent, maybe a bit less, but you know, we cannot arrive to no forecast errors. So to me, it's much more profitable to discuss what is the appropriate optimal monetary policy given a certain potentially time-varying level of uncertainty, at times very large, rather than continuing to do hindsight analysis with the benefit of hindsight. Thank you.